The year was 1958, the world was just a decade into the Cold War, and relations between the United States and the Soviet Union were tense. The space race had just kicked off, and the United States was already losing to the Soviet Union in a pretty humiliating way. So at a research facility in Illinois, Americans hatched an unthinkable plan in an attempt to show the world who they thought was really winning. This is the secret plot to nuke the moon. Hey, I'm Chase, and welcome to Keep Curious Kill. In today's video, we're going to be talking about the unfortunately very real plan to detonate a nuclear warhead on the moon, who proposed it, and why this was even a consideration in the first place. By the end of 1957, the Soviet Union had launched the first intercontinental ballistic missile, the first satellite into space, and the first mammal into orbit. That same year, all the United States had was a failed launch of the Vanguard TV-3, the United States' first satellite, which exploded almost immediately after launch on the launch pad. This was a humiliating blow, not just to the US Navy who was in charge of the launch, but to the country as a whole. The Soviet Union was upstaging the United States, and they were not shy about rubbing it in. They even sarcastically offered technological aid that was typically reserved for undeveloped countries. The United States was losing, one of the number one things the United States does not like to do, and they were doing it on the global stage in the sky. So how is Washington to remind the world of America's unfaltering and ever-increasing superiority? In 1949, the Armor Research Foundation, or ARF, was researching the effects of nuclear explosions on the environment. About 9 years later, in 1958, the United States Air Force came to them with a proposal, saying something to the effect of, "Wouldn't it be neat if we could somehow nuke the moon and study the fallout?" Somehow, enough people agreed, and the resulting ultra-classified project was called Project A119. 10 scientists were assigned to this project, and it was headed up by American physicist Leonard Riefel. And one of those 10 members, believe it or not, was Carl Sagan, who was actually a doctoral student in Chicago at the time. He was responsible for figuring out how the dust cloud would behave once the nuke actually hit the moon. And he even sort of leaked the name of the project 1 year later in 1959 when he was applying for a scholarship at UC Berkeley, though nothing really came of it at the time. As you've probably guessed, the motivations for launching a nuclear warhead at the moon were not quite the same for the scientists and the United States Air Force. While scientists were interested in studying the effects of a nuclear explosion in a low-gravity, near-vacuum environment, like the moon, the Air Force was far more interested in the effects that the blast on the moon would have back down on Earth, particularly in the Soviet Union. Part of the project involved choosing a location for the strike, and the moon's terminator, or the ever-moving line between the dark and light side of the moon, was the intended target. This was to make certain that the explosion could be seen from Earth. If the explosion could not be seen with the naked eye from Earth, the overall benefit to the US military and government would kind of be nullified, and the project likely wouldn't have gone much farther than just the initial proposal. Project A119 made it as far as selecting the specific bomb that was to be used. A W-25 nuclear warhead was chosen for the project, which had a yield of only 1.7 kilotons, roughly 11% the yield of Little Boy, the bomb the US dropped on Hiroshima during World War II. For scale, this is what the estimated blast and radiation radii would look like on Earth if it hit New York's Central Park. Or, if you're a West is Bester, it'd be roughly the length of the entire Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco. Though this would have been on the moon, and I'm not Carl Sagan, so I'm not going to pretend to know how that actually would have gone. In January 1959, 9 months into the project, the United States Air Force shut it down.
Thank God.
While the technology was mostly there to ensure a successful hit on the moon, there were a lot of fears that if it did miss, that it would basically boomerang around the moon and hurl back and strike Earth, which we can all agree would be less than ideal. Project A119 would remain a secret until 2000, when it was leaked by none other than Leonard Riefel, the man who led the research team back in 1958. As of this video, the US government has never officially acknowledged their participation in the project, though there's more than enough evidence to prove that they were in fact involved. You can actually read through a since declassified document from the Air Force Special Weapons Center called A Study of Lunar Research Flights. It's 190 pages long though, so that's entirely up to you. Interestingly, it does acknowledge that there were geopolitical motivations for the project in addition to the scientific research, but it intentionally disregards them in favor of covering the science. It actually says that in the document. In the past decade, some other documents emerged that showed that the Soviet Union was actually hatching a similar plot around the same time. They didn't get past the mock-up stage though before they put a stop to it, and from the limited information that I can gather, it was for similar reasons, citing safety concerns and threats to future lunar research. And for those curious or worried that another project like this could pop up at any time, a few treaties have been set up that now require nuclear testing to take place underground. Though not all countries have signed them, and some countries that have signed them haven't ratified them, at least the possibility is on the radar of the general public. And if it were brought up again, it wouldn't just sound like some low-budget sci-fi movie plot. Plus, it's just all-around better PR to stick a man on the moon rather than shooting a hole in it. Hey, thanks so much for watching. If you have any thoughts, comments, or history-related ideas you'd like to see next, throw them down below. And if you want to see what's next, make sure to hit that subscribe button to keep in touch. Thanks again, and I'll see you in the next one. Until then, keep curious.